Charlie, do you know what this sign says? No, okay, I'll give you a clue. It's the name of a place. No, oh. It's also the name of a television program. Swizzle Street, that's right. Again to Swizzle Street. Why do Chinese people have such strange writing? Well, it's not strange. The thing is that we learnt different signs and symbols to the ones that the Chinese learnt because we learnt English. Oh gosh, how did all the different languages develop? Well, the thing is, many, many years ago, people, if they wanted to talk to each other, they couldn't because they didn't have words. So they had to develop their own set of words. And so slowly, different languages grew up in different groups. But what happened, though, when people wanted to write to each other, they couldn't because they hadn't got any written words. So what they did was to start drawing messages on the walls of their caves. This started way back in time with the cavemen. They used to paint pictures on the walls of their caves in order to tell stories or leave messages to each other. Well, gradually, the pictures started turning into simple signs or symbols because they were much easier and quicker to write. As writing improved, people began to use better materials to write on. This man's writing on a piece of wood. Others wrote on stone by carefully chipping out their words. This man is doing his writing in wet clay with a stick. In Rome, the schoolboys wrote on wax boards. They made deep marks in the wax. But it was the Chinese who made the first real paper from linen rags. The Egyptians left us many things to read. This structure shows how they did picture writing. Each picture stands for a different word. Well, later on, the pictures became squiggles, as they could be written much more quickly than pictures. Well, other people used groups of marks to write with. Each group of marks were put in a pattern, which stood for a different sound. The first alphabet had 22 letters. Some of them look a little bit like our letters, don't they? The alphabet began as pictures. Now, can you see how it developed? Look at the picture of the camel. That was shortened to a letter that looks like a 7. And because camels were then called gamels, the camel sign became the letter G. Well, nowadays, most people learn to read and write at school. And you know, it's not very difficult as well to learn a different language too. Now, writing as a form of communication is very useful, as it means that we can communicate with people who are many, many miles away, as well as communicating with people who are nearby. But the thing is, none of that would be possible without our mail service. And did you know that many, many years ago, post boxes actually moved? Post boxes were carried on the postman's back as he walked around the city. People would pop in their letters as he walked by, and he would then take the box back to the post office to be opened. Letter boxes were later fastened to buildings, but the postmen were so frightened of losing their jobs that they put mice into them to eat the letters. And it was a good 50 years before the new boxes were accepted. Well, it's so quick and easy to write a letter and pop it in the post that we don't actually think about it. Well, I wonder if you know what this place is. Well, if you haven't already guessed, it's a postal sorting office. And in fact, it's the postal sorting office at Hong Kong for the international mail. Well, let's have a look now and see what trip my letter's going to take when it gets there. On each mailbox there is a sign which says what time the mail is picked up every day. And at these times the postman will come in a van and take all the mail to the sorting office. The parcels and letters will be sorted out and sent to different areas in the office on different colour-coded conveyor belts. The letter mail is sorted by hand into airmail and local mail. The airmail is put on the top and the local mail is put on the bottom of the belt. Each letter is placed on the conveyor belt the proper way round, with the stamp on the right, so that it's in the correct place for stamping in the franking machine. Well, in this machine, about 10 letters are stamped every 1 second. Well, here's the local mail being stamped and piled up. The letters are stamped so that the stamps are cancelled and can't be used again. It also lets the receiver know from where and when the letter was sent. The airmail letters are sorted even further by hand into different countries. Letters written in English can go anywhere in the world, whereas letters written in Chinese can only go to the Chinese-speaking countries. So letters written in any other language have to be returned back to the sender. Airmail parcels are sorted in the same way, but into big bags with a country's name on the top. Well, local mail letters are sorted into streets and blocks in Kowloon. There's Nathan Road. Well, for letters to Chim Sa Choi and Hung Hom, the postman actually comes straight to the sorting office to sort out and collect their mail. So any mail for that area will get there even faster, and the rest will go in the mail van to different area post offices. Sorted mail is put into bags and clipped back onto the elevator to go to the vans to be taken to your local post office. And then they will be packed by your local postman in his own way, so that he can take the easiest and quickest way to your house. And if you're anything like me, I'm sure you really love receiving letters in the morning. This letter a little while ago from a young lady by the name of Sophie Taylor, who's aged 7 3/4. And Sophie asked me if I would write to her. Well, the problem is, Sophie, you didn't put your address in the letter, so I don't know where I can contact you. So will you write to me, please, and then I know where I can get hold of you. And also that applies to anybody who's writing to me. Please put your name, address and telephone number somewhere in the letter so I can reply to you at some time. Well, a few weeks ago, we were looking at shape. And the children who are in the studio did some really lovely shape pictures. And I'm pleased to say that I've received a whole bunch of them in the mail. Don't they look lovely? Well, here they all are in today's gallery. And the first picture in today's gallery is of a butterfly. And that's by Samantha Martin. And here's a lovely people pattern. And that's by Ricky Lee. And an aeroplane flying up to the sun. That's by Damien Hicks. And a beautiful house with tissue paper as flowers in the garden. And that's by Adil Ansari, who's age 6. And this one is a pattern and it has no name. And finally, we have a smiling face on a television set, and that's by Peter Alderdice. Well, thank you everybody for those super pictures. Let's move over now to see What's With Roz. Hi, what we've got today is a bit of printing using letters stuck to blocks. Now, when people started printing newspapers and books, they used individual blocks with letters upraised on the blocks. Now, what we're going to do today is use the same thing using string for the letters. We paint on the letters and then we print on the paper. It's very simple, but what you have to remember, the main thing is to stick your letter back to front, because when you come to stick it onto the paper, it turns around the right way. Okay, so what we do is, I've just got some cardboard from the top of a cardboard box, top flaps, and just cut it into little squares. Now what we use is a little bit of string. Natural fibers are the best because the paint tends to adhere to it better. And then we get a little bit of glue and just put it along the top of the cardboard block, and we can attach our string to that and make up letters just by putting the string along there. And then putting on the various parts of the letter. So I can show you that with one I've done already. There is a G, but it's back to front. Don't forget to do it back to front. Okay, now I'm going to do a little message for Tracy. I think she needs a new sign for her gallery. So first of all, paint the string on the block. Don't be afraid if it smudges a bit. That's the fun of it. And press down on the paper. When you lift it up, you have a little string word, another colour. Painting my string letters here. I wonder what it's going to say. I have another colour. Turn it round and show you. There's my little sign made with the string. Now another thing you can do is just have lots of fun using letters, not necessarily meaning anything, just printing them around on a piece of paper so that they make patterns. You can make borders with them and then do pictures maybe on it. In the middle, there we are. See what else we can do. There we are, that sort of thing. Making patterns all the way around, and they don't necessarily mean anything. Okay, well that's all we've got time for now. I'll be with you next week, and now it's time for a little break. Tracy will be with you after the break.
Welcome back to part two. Now, would you believe that these, when I put them together, say, "I'll meet you tonight"? Now, it doesn't really look like it, does it? But if I take this one, put it underneath, and hold it firm, you will see that you can read, "I'll meet you tonight." So what I've done is to take a sentence, split it up over two lines, cut it in half, and then separate them into two nonsense words. And it's a code, something you can do with your friends, because as long as your friend knows how to break the code, then nobody else can read your message except your friend. Well, I can also see if you can do this with Swizzle Street. Now, if you have a look there, I've written Swizzle Street, starting it off in the code. So there we are, Swizzle Street. And then what I've done is to take the top line and make that into one word, and then the bottom line and make that into the second word, so you get a real nonsense word. And then I take an ATV and I've done exactly the same with ATV. Well, if you can't remember the whole of the Swizzle Street address, then why don't you wait until the end of the show and jot it down with a pen and paper, and then you can finish off writing this in code. And I'll give you the answer to it next week. Well, what now? How about a story? And this week's story is called Mr. Bear Postman. One day, Mr. Bear bought a bicycle and started to teach himself how to ride it. He could climb on all right and pedal, but he could not stay on. The little rabbits watched him all day as he got on, fell off, got on, fell off, got on, and fell off again. But Mr. Bear was very patient and he was determined, so in the end he managed to stay on. Well, the little rabbits wondered why he'd taken so much trouble. But the next day, they found out when Mr. Bear appeared in a new hat as the village postman. He'd learned to ride a bicycle so that he could get from house to house with his new post bag. Well, the first morning, Mr. Bear was very busy. To start with, he had to learn where all the rabbits lived. And then there were the letters to take to most of them, parcels for a few, and even one or two telegrams. Well, sometimes the addresses were so badly written that he could hardly read them. And sometimes, too, he left things at the wrong houses and had to go back for them. Well, after lunch, Mr. Bear's work began all over again, and by the middle of the afternoon, his legs were so sore that he had to sit down for rest. He was too tired to notice that he had not shut his post bag properly. And suddenly a gust of wind blew all the letters out of it. "Help!" shouted Mr. Bear. Well, luckily the little rabbits saw what had happened. "We'll get them back," they said. Soon all the letters were safely shut up once more in the post bag, and it was almost dark when Mr. Bear delivered the last letter. As he set off home, the moon seemed to smile at him. "Oh, it was hard work," thought Mr. Bear, "but I really enjoyed it. I've made lots of people happy today." After that, Mr. Bear took round the post bag every day and he met lots of new friends. But only one thing made him feel sad. In a lonely cottage that he passed each morning, there was an elderly rabbit who never, ever got a letter. Mr. Bear wondered why no one wrote to her. In the village, he asked whether she had any relations. "Oh, yes," said one of the rabbits. "She has a granddaughter who lives about 50 miles away." When he got home, Mr. Bear had a wonderful idea. "I could write a letter to that elderly rabbit," he thought, "and if I don't sign it, she'll think it comes from her granddaughter." Well, he took a long time to write the letter because he couldn't write very well. And he liked to imagine how the elderly rabbit would smile when she opened it. Next day, Mr. Bear took the letter he'd written and handed it to the elderly rabbit. Her eyes widened with surprise, and she smiled just the way he'd imagined. "Oh, thank you, Mr. Postman," she said, and then she scurried off into her house with the letter. Mr. Bear tiptoed up to her window to watch the elderly rabbit read the letter. She looked so pleased with it that he decided to write one for her every single day, and that's just what he did. But one day, when Mr. Bear brought his usual letter to the cottage, a little rabbit girl was standing beside the elderly rabbit. "This is my granddaughter, Mr. Postman," said the elderly rabbit. "She's come to visit me." Mr. Bear quickly hid his letter behind his back and hurried away. Well, the next day was Sunday, so Mr. Bear was at home. He just started to clean his bike when he heard someone cough. He looked up, and there was the elderly rabbit's little granddaughter. "Thank you for writing Granny those letters," she said. "How did you know?" asked Mr. Bear. Oh, I saw the letter in your hand when you came yesterday, she said. You took it away without delivering it, so I knew you must have written it. Does your granny know I wrote the letters? Asked Mr. Bear. Oh, I don't think so, answered the little rabbit, but she knows they didn't come from me. Mr. Bear looked puzzled. Well, how did she find out then? He asked. The little rabbit picked up his hat and put it on her head. Mr. Postman, she answered, always forgot to stick any stamps on them. Well, I thought it's about time we had another competition again, but before you go running off to get your pencils and paper to write a story, then just have a look at this. This is a message that has been written in pictures, almost like a comic strip. Now, each picture tells a story, and all it takes is a little imagination to work it out. Now, you see pirates sailed to an island, they buried treasure, and then one man drew a map. Would you get the idea? Now, your pictures don't have to be as detailed as that. All you have to do is write the simple story using very, very simple pictures, but just enough to create the imagination of the person who's reading it. Now, have a look at this. For example, I've got a girl here that I've done, very, very simply. Now, you can see it's a girl because I've done a little triangle for a skirt. Now, perhaps I might like to do a boy. So I'll draw a circle, again like the girl, but I could perhaps put a pair of shorts on him, just so we know it's a little boy. And there, I haven't written anything on there, but I'm sure you can see the difference between the boy and the girl. Now, I've got a house on the next one. Is it daytime or is it nighttime? Well, how can we show daytime? Let's see, how about a simple sun? That will show it's daytime. So in the corner, I could just draw a very simple picture of a sun to show that it's a house in daytime. Now, if it was nighttime, I might draw the moon just to show that it's nighttime with that house. And finally, people sometimes get confused between stick drawings of dogs and cats. So I've drawn a dog, and you can see it's a dog because I've put a bone in his mouth, and I don't think anybody can dispute that that's a dog. So as you see, all you have to do is keep your pictures very, very simple, just a few of them, to write your little story or message. Well, let's have a look at the details once again. Draw a story, but you mustn't use any words at all. Just make simple, very simple pictures. Now, it can be in black and white, or it can be in colour, whichever you prefer. And don't forget to put your name, age, address, and telephone number. And send it to me before the 10th of September. That's just 2 weeks away. So get cracking as soon as the show's over. And I'll give you the address to send it to at the end of the show. In my hand, I'm using a type of coded message that was used many, many years ago in the time of the Spartans. Now, the Spartans were always at war with each other and other people, and the army generals used to send messages to each other. Now, the thing is, other people got to read those messages, so they had to devise a code. I'll put this down and I'll show you how you can write your own code. Now, what you do is to take some sort of cylinder. In fact, you'll need a couple because your friend will need one of these as well to decode your code. Take a cylinder, take a long strip of paper, and fix the strip of paper onto the cylinder using a very simple paper clip. Like so. Make sure it's nice and secure. Then you start wrapping round the paper around the cylinder, overlapping it very slightly just so it doesn't slip around. Do this a few more times. There we are. And then just to secure it so that it doesn't all suddenly unravel and flip up, I'll stick some sellotape onto the end. Now what you do is to start writing your message going across each of the different sections. So I'll start first of all by writing my name, is, and then Tracy. Now, I haven't written that brilliantly, but you can see my message says, my name is Tracy. Now, the thing is, The enemy might be able to work out, once I've unraveled this, what my code is. So I want to confuse them a bit. So just to show you, I will take a different colour. You'd usually do this in the same colour. And put a few nonsense letters on, so that when it's wrapped up again, it confuses the other people. So I'll put an L, a P, and an O there. Let's fill that one in with an L, an M, E, Y. And I think that's just about it. Now, so as you can see, I filled in all the spare places on my code. Now I'll unravel it, and you can see what it looks like when it's unraveled. There you are. Looks like an absolute load of nonsense. Just lots of different letters all mixed up together. And nobody would be able to work out that that says, "My name is Tracy." Right, let's have a look now and see what that one was at the beginning. I'll put it back on. This is what you would do if you wrote one for a friend. You give it to a friend and they take a piece of wood exactly the same size and wrap it round. What this one says. I'll start at the beginning, which seems to be there, and it says, "Why don't you write in?" And if you'd like to write to me, then this is the address. My name's Tracy King, write to Swizzle Street, room 430, 81 Broadcast Drive, Kowloon. Well, Ros and I will be back next week with some amazing transformations and some great puppets to show you. And also, it will be the results of our watch competition. But until then, take care. I'll see you next week.